Hello, everyone. Welcome back to another episode of the Moss House Podcast. I'm here with our current artist in residence, Koyo. And I'll let you say your last name because I'm going to butcher it myself.
It's my full name, Koyoltzintli.
Yes. Okay, well, I definitely cannot say that. All right, so how are you feeling today?
Hi, Hunter. I'm feeling really, really good. I had a really wonderful day near the ocean. It's just been a really, really beautiful last day at Ma's house.
Yeah, today was a very busy day. Although our original what we set out to do didn't really get it done, but well, it was still fun. I enjoyed myself still.
Yes.
We got to see a bunch of cool places and all around, I guess, all the way to Conscious Point, which is nice. I'd never really even been there myself, so it's nice to finally check it out. Don't hopefully anyone that listens to this does not hate me for that. So, can you do a little bit to describe your art? Actually, before you do that, anybody listening, we're also making a YouTube video of the podcast because Koyo is currently making some art right now. So if you want to know what she's making, come watch the video. It's going to be on the Moss House YouTube. All right, so can you describe your art for us?
Absolutely. I am a multidisciplinary artist. I have been working in the field of photography for the past maybe 15 years by now. Started as a photojournalist, then I moved into documentary photography, then I moved into fine art photography, and through fine art, I also explored different alternative processes. And from that, it actually quite recently, around the time of the pandemic, I started expanding my practice and incorporating performance and more drawings. And it is at that time in 2020, early 2020, that I also discovered pre-Columbian instruments, specifically from my ancestral homelands. And since then, I've been creating instruments. So this that you, for those of you that are watching, what I'm doing is burnishing a piece, but hopefully you'll be able to see other pieces that I have in the table.
Yeah. So what are you doing right now with that rock? How does that work?
So this is a we call it burnishing, but in Spanish it's actually called bruñido. And what it is just making the piece as shiny as possible. So when you fire it, it has this very smooth, brilliant surface. It really does not affect the sound quality of the pieces at all, but it is a beautiful technique and it's also a very meditative technique. So I think more than anything, one of the reasons why I do it is because it allows me to spend time with this clay before it gets fired. And when I do the burnishing, when I do the polishing, it makes me just it's like makes me think about how this instrument wants to be played, or I, you know, just get visions of like if I need to do any type of design or decoration to it. So it's just a time to spend a little bit more with the piece before it gets fired and before I really cannot do much to it. So it's a really good practice, at least for me, to do this.
How do you know when to stop?
Do you know when to stop? Yeah. Well, the one that I'm holding in my hands right now is probably at a stopping point. Every single angle that I touch is burnished, so then I know, and it's very soft all throughout the piece. So that's when I know it's finished. And the way that I do my best test is by closing my eyes. I find that sometimes when we have our eyes open, we're a little bit biased to want to be done. But when we close our eyes, our hands cannot lie. So much of clay process for me is about really allowing your hands to take center stage and allowing it to touch the clay and to tell you, you know, when it's done and when it needs more work.
That's very interesting. I really like that one that you were just holding, by the way. That one's awesome.
Thank you.
So, how did you discover Ma's house?
Good question. I think that I saw, I'm trying to go as far back as I can remember. Okay. I saw Jeremy's work. I was a previous light work fellow, and I saw that he was a current light work fellow at, I don't know, maybe 2 years ago. And I saw his work, and I thought it was really interesting. It was really beautiful. And I started following him, and at some point while I was following him, he posted about Mass House, and I became immediately interested in the residency, but because I was also teaching and I was living a little bit too far, I never applied. So whenever I had, then this time that I had the opportunity to apply, I just jumped and did it.
Yeah, we're glad to have you. Your workshop was awesome the other day.
Thank you.
So, what has been your some of your favorite moments here so far? How long, you've been here for like 2 weeks now?
2 weeks.
2 weeks, yeah.
Yeah. I think it's such a quiet place, and it's such a serene environment that I think one of my best times really has been about having a continuous studio practice. So, and not being at my home, so just waking up, going for a small walk, just feeling the sun coming back and working on instruments or on articles that I'm reading or things that I need to that I'm preparing to teach. And yeah, and just spending the day in this like continuous creative flow that Mass House has allowed me to do.
Speaking of teaching, what sort of subjects do you usually teach? Is it art or?
Yeah, I usually teach art. I teach, well, I've been teaching a lot of flute classes, flute making, globular flute making, like the one that you were at. And I also teach photography. I mean, I'm still very active in the photo scene. So whenever I get invited to teach or to give a lecture, I'm happy to go. Just teaching in general is really part of my practice. I enjoy it very much, and I enjoy sharing it with younger generations.
A little tidbit of information about me. I don't think I've told anybody, at least on the podcast. I used to be a teacher also for 1 year,
Ah,
yeah, just one school
nice.
year, and then I guess actually I was an intern at that school, and then once I left college, they offered me a full-time job there, which I took.
That's
So
amazing.
yeah,
That's so great.
it was fun, very rewarding,
Yeah.
but very stressful, kind of too, especially
Yeah.
working with children. Oh my God, it's so stressful to be
Absolutely.
responsible for people.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was too much for me. But maybe one day that can be my backup, since I do have some experience. I can
Yeah.
go back to doing that
True.
if my podcast gets taken down forever and kicked off the air.
I don't think so.
You never know. All it takes is one thing. Okay, so it seems in my head, I'm going to assume that now pottery and instrument making are now your favorite medium. But as a multidisciplinary artist, what is your favorite, if you have one?
Yeah, I think that you're right. I think that that right now I'm so immersed in making the instruments, playing them, using them in a more of a daily basis, that they really have a lot of my attention as an artist, as a person, as a healer, as someone who comes from this lineage. So I think, yeah, it like really pulls a lot of different areas of who I am into like this one place. So I'm really enjoying my time. And also I'm quite new at clay. I think, yeah, I've been doing it for 2 years, maybe a little less than that. So I still feel like I have a lot to learn. But aside from that, I mean, I still love to do alternative photography. I love to do performances. I love to use my body in whenever I can to do some work. So, yeah.
What is alternative photography?
Alternative photography is a very terrible term because it should be called traditional photography, not alternative. Yeah. So alternative photography is known as anything that does that first is known as like the earlier type of photography, cyanotype and like brown, photographs with a large camera, with plate, and like different experimental processes. So that was, so like the beginning of photography from the 1800s to the like early 1910s, around their 1920s, these processes were the main ways people took photographs. And then you get the introduction of the 35 millimeter camera with film, and that becomes a standard. So anything that is outside the standard becomes alternative, but it really is an alternative. It is actually the first way of capturing image was through this other techniques.
So like that giant box thing with the lamp, then you press that little button and it goes on?
Yeah, like that.
You do that? That's
very interesting. Yeah, yeah. I mean, and creating like those boxes, making sure that they work, and like figuring out the lens so they work. I mean, that is the beginning of photography.
That is pretty awesome. You make the boxes yourself?
I could, yeah. Yeah.
That's pretty impressive. I never would even imagine to do that.
Oh, no, it's actually quite fun. The photo quality is, it's limited. But I think that there is a magic that could be created. Like once you know your limitations, mm-hmm. you know, then yeah, you can do. I mean, really, I think that everything has a limitation, and because it's a technical, it's an apparatus, right? So it's gonna have some type of limitation. But because we use all these like super smart cameras now. And everything is so sharp, and we can like literally take a really good photo in like pitch black, then we feel kind of limitless. But with these other processes, there's more of a subjective possibility. So instead of taking a crisp photo of a beach, you're taking an image that is like softer in focus. So it captures something else.
That's interesting. Because a lot of people nowadays with the newer cameras try to capture something like the traditional cameras do. And I've been asked to be like, oh, can you edit it so it looks like this?
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, I could. But it's so interesting. I never really thought that I should just use the other stuff.
Yeah.
And now that there's like 4K cameras and everything's so nice. Speaking of limitations, like how good can it really, like how much better? If it goes to 8K or 12K, it would really look that much better to my eye. I am starting to doubt that, honestly. I don't think so.
Yeah.
There's definitely got to be a limit. We'll reach the limit. I want to see what the limit is. Okay. Okay. How does the way you make your art change on residency rather than when you're at home?
I think I'm more productive at a residency because there's less of the everyday that I have to deal with. And this is why residencies are short and sweet, because they really, you find this amount of time where you can go focus on your work. But I also have a family, I have a dog. So if I spend too long, I'm going to start missing my dog and missing being in my room and like my whole routine at home, you know, but so like this amount of time that I spend here is just perfect because I can just focus on my art and know that, okay, in 2 weeks I'm back home, so everything is fine.
Hmm. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So this is kind of a more just open-ended question. I've been asking a bunch of artists this. What do you think is the most important personality trait for an artist to have?
Patience. Patience. That will be my number one. Patience. Yeah. I mean, I think, I think that's something that happens sometimes. I don't know if this happens to every artist, but at least it happens to me and it happens to the artists that I work with, that, you know, sometimes we have a vision and it doesn't come through the way we want. So we become impatient. We want to do something to change it. We want to redo it, or we get frustrated. And sometimes just taking a moment to breathe and looking at that work again and seeing like, okay, why did it come out this way? What do I need to learn? What do I need to change? And do I need to do anything else? it's like a thing, but it doesn't, it happens when we take a moment and really look at what we're making. So for me, it will be patience. But I do have a second one, a backup, and that will be, spontaneity. Yeah. So it will be number one, patience, but number two, like very, very close competitor will be spontaneity.
They almost are opposites, I feel like.
Oh, isn't it interesting? Yeah. Well, you know, I think that art kind of thrives in that space, you know, in the space of like in-betweenness, where you can, you know, because I think someone once said to me, if all the mysteries in the world were revealed, there will be no need for artists. And when I think about that, I think about how through art we really like we thrive and exist in liminal spaces where we try to figure something out, but it's not yet tangible. It's in our minds. So how do we create that bridge to make it happen? So
very interesting. Mm-hmm. I'm definitely working on the first one, patience. But I feel like I'm pretty spontaneous. Usually.
Yeah.
If I'm in a bad mood, then I'm like, I don't want to do that. But make it work. So why do you make art?
Because if I to me, when you ask that question, I think about like, and why do you eat? You know, is that essential? It really is. It is a blessing, and sometimes is something that you carry and that you need to respond to. Like I have, yeah. So I wouldn't call it a burden because it's not, but it is that same necessity as like you wake up and you're hungry and you have to eat. So you go and like make food and there's no thought about it. And for me, art, I can take time off for sure. But then at some point, ideas come through. Mm-hmm. And I'm just like, I have to do that. And it doesn't matter if I have to scale it down or scale it up. But it comes through and it's just, it has to come out.
Very well said. Interesting way to think about it for sure. So kind of second part to that question. What are some of the things that inspire you to make art?
Life, memory, a land, life, land, and memory. I think that will be the answer, the very sure answer.
Interesting. Well, I'll try to think of a good time to play part of the instruments. I feel like now is a good time to just show off.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I'm really interested in that big one.
Absolutely. Yeah, so this is a water flute. It has to be, I still need to varnish it, and I still, and it has to get fired, but you get to see two sounds. So the idea is that instead of using my mouth to blow, you put water in here, and it will create that same sound that you're about to listen.
Water will make that sound?
Yes. There is an inner chamber inside the two bottles that connect that tosses the water from one side to the other, and it allows that the push of the air to blow into the whistle.
That is pretty amazing, I'll say. I can't believe a human made that.
Yes, a human 3,000 years ago. It's pretty incredible. Like, yeah. Our ancestors are geniuses. They're just incredible.
I'll just reiterate again to everybody who's listening to the podcast. If you want to see what that thing looks like, because it's pretty amazing to look at, go check out the video we're going to post about this, because it's truly something else.
Yeah.
I tried to make one. Nothing like that, but Much smaller. Could you show that the three-piece one?
Yeah, so this here is a triple globular flute. It's quite small. Usually I make them much, much bigger, but I wanted to see how small it looks like. And then this one is a double flute. So I'm just going to play this one so you can hear how it sounds. And this has a interesting sound. So it's something called polyrhythm. So it's two sounds that are almost equal in hertz, but they have like 10 to 15 hertz in difference. So they create, it's so some of these instruments try to imitate or try to connect, because they usually, the way that I've been taught is like, is that it's not about imitation, it's about connection. So you hear a cricket, you hear a cicada, and they do that sound like zzzz. And the reason why it's so penetrating, and we call it white noise, is because it has that natural polyrhythm happening. So they created this instrument to connect with the energy of these little insects. So the water whistle, in that way, similar, they try to imitate the sound of birds.
Yeah, that noise, I have like my ears miss a certain frequency, and that one might have been the frequency, because it sounded, I could hear it, but just,
yeah,
it sounded so interesting in my ears. I've never really heard that noise.
Yeah, so. Like it's like, you know, some people will call it dissonant, because it's not the usual harmonics that we listen to. So then this could feel a little dissonant to hear something that is just like, and you cannot identify one or the other, but you're going to have to mix both of them. And then your ears are going like, you know, your conscious is going like back and forth, back and forth, back and forth.
Yeah. Very interesting. But I made one ball, basically, and it was very, very difficult. Like, I don't know how this should mean. People will probably have a much easier time than I did, but it was truly difficult for me. But it actually works. Mine's all the way at the end of the room, but it's drying. And before this, I was trying to get it to work, and I actually got it to work for like 4 seconds. And
that's so good. That's nice. That's what you need, just like those first 4 seconds.
Yeah, I got it to work, and I was very happy.
Yeah.
And I almost cried because of how nice it was. But, okay, so... how long have you been making art for?
Well, I would say since I'm a child. I started with playing the piano and the flute, and then I discovered painting. So I moved into painting. But yeah, my first art was music. Oh. And, you know, the way that they teach you piano or classical music, it was a little bit too rigid for me. It didn't allow for self-expression. I mean, now things are so different, but this is like 30 years ago when I was a small child. You know, if you wanted to play the piano, you have to read the partituras. I don't know.
These are the notes.
I don't know how to say in English. In Spanish, it's called partituras, and I would read them. You know, I knew how to read a partitura, or a I'm so sorry, I don't know the word in English. Music sheet, maybe. Oh,
yeah. I think that's what it
music
is.
Sheet. Yeah, yeah, it's so simple in English. Music sheet. Yeah. I should have started with that. and I know how to read it, but it always felt a little contrived because there's a piano and it has so many notes and you just want to play it. Like literally like play it, like have fun with it. But playing music in traditional ways, or when I say traditional, I would say more like European conventional ways, it's a lot of technique, and it's like kind of contrived, it felt to me. So I moved out of it, and then I started painting, and it felt much more liberating.
Well, I asked because when you first started, did you see yourself becoming an artist? Is that what you wanted to do?
I'm going to say yes. Mm. Yes, since I was a child, I knew that I was either going to be an artist or a marine biologist.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Those were my two paths.
Very opposite end of the spectrum, a scientist or an artist.
Yeah.
So where do you see your art taking you now?
I think I'm going to continue making instruments. I mean, ideally, I want to have like the whole table full of instruments. I would like to perform them with people. I would like to mix different traditions and have other people play, and I play, and we have like a conversation through sound that interests me. But I'm keeping it pretty open, you know. Maybe I have an idea of something that will come through and I'll do that. I also feel like I want to make costumes. Like I want to like make things with fabric and have people wear them or hand them. I'm not exactly sure what, but I want to combine that with the instruments.
Yeah. That'd be interesting. I've never made any type of clothing before.
No, me neither.
Yeah, it's going to be fun. I feel like it's hard to make it from scratch.
Yeah.
All the sewing. Difficult.
Probably will be, yeah. But, you know, like weaving, sewing is so ancient. I feel like we all know someone that weaves or sews, you know. It's like it is part of a craft legacy that is also very, like, home, right? Like cooking, right? Like having a garden, growing vegetables is very much something that has been passed down generations to generations, and it's, you know, part of livelihood.
Interesting. This is a hard question. What work are you most proud of?
Oh man, that is a hard question. You know, I think I want to say it, and I don't want to offend any of my other works, but I think I'm going to say it. I did a project called In the Mouth of the Mountain Jaguar, Everybody's a Dancing Hummingbird, and that is a project that connects fact and fiction in a rural village in Ecuador. And one of my relatives' grandmother lives there, and what I did is that because I spent for a lot of time of my life going to the same place. And in Latin America, there is this big concept or literary concept that is called magic realism. And magic realism is, it actually comes from this ethno-European centric notion of life, rural life in South America. Colombia, Ecuador, Venezuela, Mexico, Peru, all these countries, Bolivia, I mean, I'm just naming a few, but really in many. And the idea is that life is both real, but local people mix it with magic or with, yes. And it has been written about a lot. A lot of the classic writers have written about this, or there's like this genre of writing. So my take was, when I did my project, was magic is embedded in everyday life. There's no separation where a medicine woman is like, okay, I'm going to cook and now I'm going to be a medicine woman. No, it's like the same. It's all like embedded, deeply embedded in life. So the photographs were responding to that prompt, and like, just like, there's no separation, there's union. And what I did is that I invited the village to be part of the project. So I photograph with people, but I also have them photograph. And I stage photographs for them of visions that they wanted to create, like marriages that were never realized, we made them into, we staged them. Just different things, just different events. So it was beautiful to be working with a lot of people on something and realizing people's visions and dreams and having fun.
Yeah, that sounds awesome. Magic realism?
Yeah, well, that's the literary concept. So I just
check that out.
Yeah, I just took it and did my own thing with it.
Yeah. Sounds awesome. I'm going to check out the whole project. It's cool.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so that's probably it. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, well, this for anyone listening, this is trying to be a short and sweet podcast. We just hit 30 minutes, so time for a little speed. Last few questions that I like to ask people.
Let me put my instrument down so I can truly focus.
Okay. Okay, so which one should I ask first? I'll go with this one first. So I think I mentioned this supposed to be a secret one, but I think I told you about it. Do you believe in ghosts? And if so, do you have any paranormal paranormal experiences that you'd like to share?
Yes, I believe in ghosts.
Nice.
I think that I have had random possible encounters just by walking at night and turning back and seeing a silhouette, or might have seen a person, something like that. Or being in a house and I hear a door closing and I know that all the doors are closed. When I was growing up, that would scare me. But then I just thought, you know, that there is so much life, so much, energy, I would call it better, that is not perceptible through the eyes. Mm-hmm. And why would this be the exception? You know, I think that this, other beings, other realities, other dimensions exist, but we're not able to see them, and that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
So I usually tell one of the three same ghost stories, because people usually then ask me well, do you? And then, so then I'll say something. But yesterday, actually, something, so this is cool. So my most recent dog, Layla, that was living with me and my mom and my sister, she passed away probably just over a year ago now. And we buried her in our front yard. So yesterday I was going to the car to go somewhere. I think I was going to go to the P.O. box for my mom. So I walk past her grave. I'm like, oh, hello, Layla. And then I turn on the radio. And there's a song called Layla. That song is not playing. But for some reason, I have the thing on the radio that says what song's on.
Uh-huh.
The radio just said Layla. So I was like, oh, hello, Layla. She said hello. I thought she said hello to me.
Oh.
Through the radio waves, through some of the frequencies somehow.
That's beautiful. And I absolutely believe in that.
Yeah. I don't really believe in coincidences.
Me neither.
Synchronicity. Both connected somehow. So, and that's just the everyday magic you run into sometimes around here.
Absolutely. So. That's a beautiful story. Thank you for sharing.
Of course. Lots of ghost things, but I'm sure people are sick of hearing about them right now. That's a new one. So, first time I've ever told. Okay, so here's the last actual question I have for you. What is something that I should have asked you about, but I didn't?
You didn't ask me about... Well, there's so many things that you didn't ask.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, no.
But I think that my question back to you would be in terms of art or in terms of life, and in what box are we, because we could talk forever, literally.
We could talk forever.
Yeah.
I mean, it depends, whatever you think I should have asked you that you would like, that's like, oh, I wanted, that you'd be like, oh, this is a good question because you have something good to share, that something more like question that would facilitate you saying something that you want to say.
That's great. That's a better explanation. Let's see. I really can't think of anything. I think you've asked really good questions.
You just made me all afraid that I didn't ask you any of the good questions.
No, you did. You did. I really cannot think of anything that you missed.
Wow. Yeah. Guessing I'm pretty good at this. Okay. Yeah, that's my comedy. So, listen, I guess one last real question. Do you have any questions for me?
Do I have questions for you?
You can ask anything. It doesn't have to be about art.
Okay.
Within reason. Within reason.
Would you like to be interviewed someday? For a podcast? And if so, which?
You know, one thing about me is I actually don't really listen to that many podcasts, which is crazy. I really listen to my own. But, I would like to be on, this Howard Stern count. He's on the radio show.
That's good.
I feel like that'd be a fun one.
Uh-huh.
Just because I feel like then I'm actually a successful director or something, and then Howard's like, oh, let's see what this guy's up to, and invites me out. I feel like that'd be fun.
Nice. And
yeah, I'd like to be interviewed one day, but I feel like I need to don't know the word for it right now, but for lack of a better term, like consolidate my, become more established in what I'm as an artist first before people start asking me questions and stuff. So I'm still learning a lot. And which is good. I'm surrounded by people who I think are much better artists than I am all the time. So I get to take some of their, get to learn from them, take some of their techniques, and then continue learning, getting better every day, which is nice. So it's like artist boot camp for the next 2 years, which is going to be cool.
Yeah. Well, thank you for sharing that.
Of course.
I'll be attentive to your interview with Howard. Yeah, why not?
That'd be cool. I think he gets in trouble a lot, but
he does.
If I on that type of interview, I would probably be the one that gets in trouble for that during that interview. Not even Howard, but we'll see. That'd be my goal, is to be the one that gets in trouble. but let's see. I have to do something pretty bad then. Maybe I'll think of something for that. Okay. Well, I guess we've reached the end. But at the end, I always like to give all the artists an opportunity to plug all their social medias, their websites, whatever you may want to talk about now.
Yeah.
The floor is yours.
Thank you. I really have a website, an email, and an Instagram account. I don't have anything else. So if you would like to follow me, you can follow me through Instagram at Koyoltzintli, and that will be at KOYOLTZINTLI. And also my website, which is koyoltzintli.com. It's the same spelling.
And then those links will be in the description of the podcast.
Oh, they will be. Okay.
Well, it's good. It will be available. Well, now I know what to add down there. That's my way of just figuring out what type of links to put down there.
Yes.
Is that everything?
Thank you. Thank you very much for the interview. It's been a pleasure.
Yeah. Thank you. It was awesome. I had fun. I learned a lot. I feel like this is the most educational interview so far. Like I was being taught, get to see you work is always great. And then, yeah, I guess I'll just plug the. Sorry for plugging this every 10 minutes, guys, but the YouTube video, if you want to see what we're working on, what Koyo is working on right now, come check it out. The podcast will be playing in the background, and you guys can see the instruments she's made. All right, well, thanks again, Koyo. Thank you for everyone for tuning
you.
In.
Thank you. Yeah.
This is Hunter Begun. This was another episode of the Moss House Podcast. And we'll catch you guys next time.